Let me say a word about the Minnesota Achievement Gap Committee. We put on forums throughout the year on successful work or important work being done to overcome the achievement gap, which we understand in a very complex way, I want to let you know. The term is just the easy term to use, but it's a much more complex issue than that term would infer. And this year in the fall, I just want to give you a sense of what our lineup is. On October 6th at Mount Zion Temple, noon to 1:30 on Tuesday, October 6th, we will be having a presentation by Michael Rodriguez and Julie Schweitzer from the University of Minnesota on the new Education Equity Resource Center. And then in October, in cooperation with Education Evolving, we will be having three forums that will be held at the Wilder Foundation from 3:30 to 5 p.m. on asking the unasked questions, the system side of the achievement gap. It's just raising some questions about how we understand the gap. So again, that's at the Wilder Center. And then on November 17th, Sandra Samuels and the Northside Achievement Zone will be coming and giving a report on what they found and what their future is. And then on December 1st, Generation Next, RT Rybeck, and then the Mini Minds campaign will be coming on December 8th to be able to talk about where they are and their work and trying to get in sync with the governor, you know, so we don't have a division around early childhood education again this session. So that's kind of a preview of what we have coming up. Our website is mnachievementgap.org. We have over 60 of these forums on our website. So you can go there and find wonderful forums on great work that's being done to deal with this. So what's going to happen tonight? Tonight is just a forum. It's not a debate. We're only going to be asking three questions of each of the candidates. They will have 3 minutes to respond to the first two questions, 4 minutes to the last question. And now I'd like to turn the evening over to our moderator, Catherine Page, a successful elementary school principal in Columbia Heights for several years. And Catherine will be our moderator and will begin allowing the candidates 1 minute to be able to introduce themselves and to say why they're running for school board.
I too want to welcome you all and thank the candidates for coming too. We have 8 out of 9 candidates here this evening. And I will just tell you what the questions are now. The candidates all receive the questions in advance, so they know what's coming. We'll say it that way. Okay, the first question is, how do you understand the achievement gap and what causes it? The second question, what needs to be done to end the achievement gap in St. Paul Public Schools? And the third question, what are the barriers to ending the achievement gap and how do you propose to overcome them? So difficult questions. Okay, we'll start here and please give about a minute to tell us about yourself.
I'm feeling a little lonesome over here because I've got all this space. You should come this way. But you don't have to. I don't have to be. I'm Mary Van Doort. I am I'm coming to this this process with 25 years of experience in early childhood education. I spent most of my career in Head Start, both locally and at the state. I was the Head Start State Collaboration Director for 8 years. And I've worked with families, I've worked as an administrator, and I've worked in those big systems. So that's kind of a unique set of skills to bring. I also am a single mom of 3 kids who graduated from the St. Paul schools, and they are doing great despite that childhood with just me. I gave them lots of opportunities to be flexible and solve problems, but the schools gave them what they really needed to be successful, and they're doing great. So I really want all our kids in St. Paul to have the same kind of great start in life that my kids had, and want to be part of that change.
Hi, my name is John Schumacher. My wife and I are proud parents of 2 graduates of our St. Paul Public School Systems. They're both out and doing well. I'm running for the school board because I feel that we have to do a better job of engaging our community and bringing everyone together to make sure that our kids get the education that they deserve to succeed. I have experience working in the schools. I've worked as a volunteer, I've worked as a tutor, I've served on many committees and site councils. And I have also, for the past 15 years, been involved in the schools as the executive director of the St. Anthony Park Community Foundation, making sure to support teachers and schools and students with innovative learning programs in the arts and sciences. I also have experience working with boards, governance, and in mediation. So 23 years, I have basically been involved with various members of the city and stakeholders, and I've used the skills that I've learned to bring those people together to make sure that we have the kinds of communities that we all know we deserve and we want to have here in St. Paul. Thanks. Also, thanks to the League of Women Voters and Minnesota Achievement Gap and the Hallie Q. Brown Center for their hospitality. It's great to be here with all of you. Thanks.
Hello, my name is Scott Ruskevich. I've been a tennis teaching professional for 40 years, and also I worked for 17 years as a substitute school teacher, and I didn't believe it when they said it'd be the hardest job you ever had, but believe me, it was not one of the hardest jobs I've ever had. I'm running to remind all of us here that the problems with the achievement gap don't exist in isolation. They're not going to be solved with small-minded ideas from small-minded people. It's going to take big ideas. And one of the big ideas I want to throw out right now is that we've got to end this war on drugs that is tearing apart the black community. It is absolutely inexcusable that Republicans and Democrats alike are fighting this war on defenseless people, ruining their communities. And if anyone doesn't think that has a profound effect on our education, they'd better think again. This is absolutely ridiculous. We've got to end this war against people, because remember, it's not a war against drugs, it's a war against people. We've got to stop it right now.
Hi, my name is Steve Marchese, and I am a parent of two kids in the St. Paul schools. I have a son who is a seventh grader at Capitol Hill Magnet School and a 10th grader at Central High School. I live here, not very far from the Hallie Q. Brown Center here in the Summit University neighborhood. And I'm a lawyer by training. I work at the State Bar Association and I run the pro bono programs for the State Bar, which means I work a lot with legal aid and legal services programs, connecting their clients to lawyers to take their cases because they can't afford to pay. When I was in practice, I worked in litigation, and I represented families and kids in special education proceedings. Before I moved to Minnesota, I practiced in Michigan, and I represented parents and kids in a school desegregation case in Western Michigan. So I kind of come to this for a few different reasons. One, I'm a parent, and it's very personal. When we bring our children to the schools, every parent wants the best for their child. Regardless of where they come from, regardless of who they are, they want to know that they can trust the schools to do the best job for them. We also have not had the opportunity at the building level, at the district level, to give the kind of input as parents and educators and as community members to the work that we need to do. So this is a big topic. I'm excited to talk about this with you. We have a lot of work to do, and we really need our community engaged in this work.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I'm Keith Hardy from your St. Paul Board of Education. And I am excited to be here. Thank you, Catherine, the League of Women Voters. Thank you, Grant and Minnesota Achievement Gap Committee. And thank you, Jonathan, and the leaders and staff here in this center, named after a great community leader and connected with one of the great community leaders and civic leaders. I am a 27-year active and ardent member of the DFL party, and that hasn't changed. It was a difficult but a community decision that I'm still a candidate for the school board for the next 4 years. I am committed and focused on having every student who, like my son Andre, successful sophomore this year, to have that opportunity, that support, and that avenue for high academic and life success. That's what I'm focused on as a school board member right now. That's what I'll continue to focus on over the next 4 years. I look forward to our conversation.
Hi, I'm Linda Freeman, and I'm going to read tonight to stay on track for time. I'm running for school board because our public schools provide our children with hope,
opportunity, and power. And the school board provides me with a position to assure that all our St. Paul families have access to this. I offer many years' experience as a teacher and parent in our St. Paul schools and other progressive programs. Elsewhere, I'm a licensed K-6 teacher, Montessori trained, and my passion for education has led me to graduate work in this field. My training informs many of the decisions I'll be making. I'm very interested in early childhood education, and I'll be looking for input from our current programs and plans in this area. As a parent of now adult children, I've experienced the joys and challenges of schools through high school and college. This experience has included steering committees, site council, and parent groups. As a homeowner in Frogtown for around 20 years, I've been immersed in the struggle many of our low-income children bring to their education. I'm confident and prepared to weigh into the forward-moving possibilities in our schools, whether they're change or momentum.
Thank you all. Very informative. Oh, I'm sorry, didn't see you down there.
That's just the way we rehearsed it, wasn't it? Of course. Good evening. Thank you for coming. You're the power to make change in our community. And the people that are watching this broadcast are the people that can make the change in our community. It's a change that we desperately need to make. And that's why I'm running. Not to embrace the status quo, but to be the change agent that we haven't had on the board. Now, we do have a guy that didn't vote to extend a certain individual's contract with us tonight. He needs some help. I'm that help. I believe that Ms. Silva's reign should come to an end. I think that our community cannot stand one more year, two more years, let alone three more years beyond the terms of anybody on the current school board. That's why I'm running. And I'm very excited about the possibility of making that change. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Now we'll start with our first candidate again, and we'll go through our three questions. Go ahead.
Yes. And this is my microphone now, since you guys didn't move down. I think the achievement gap is commonly known as the difference between what our white, well-resourced children are achieving in school and what our kids from lower income and communities of color are doing. I think the data this morning that was released about the incomes of African American households in this state is really disheartening because we seem to be going backwards. But it's a complex problem. It's not a problem to be owned totally by the schools. It is a community issue. We've got systemic racism that affects our housing policies, our health practices, our justice and law enforcement systems, and all of those need to be addressed by the community. But within the schools, we've got children who come from low income. I knew lots of them when I worked in Head Start. They really do have fewer opportunities for having access to healthy food, to having safe housing and health care. They have fewer parks for physical activity and little exposure to nature. Access to mental health services is also limited. In their homes, they also have access to fewer books and fewer words, and that's a disadvantage when they get to school. And far too many of our kids are exposed to violence and other negative influences. And their parents are doing the best they can. They are working many jobs. They are living with all kinds of challenges themselves. And it's really hard for them to be supportive of their children and to be involved in their schools as well. So when they come to school, they're behind. And many of them have lost hope. That's from what they see in their communities, from what they've seen in their own families. What they expect is they're going to move into prisons. They're going to move into the same things they've been seeing in their communities. So why bother? And so I think that our schools really need to be inspiring for those kids and to provide the things that they aren't getting at home. I think we need to start earlier with, I'm an early childhood person, we need to start early with our children and families. We need to start the minute that that families are expecting their babies. Oh my gosh, it's only 30, I have only 30 seconds left. I have to talk really fast. We gotta start early, we gotta support parents. We have to pay attention to kids' health, and we gotta make sure that our schools allow teachers to have strong relationships with both their kids and their families. How'd I do, Mary? I still have seconds?
Okay. Pass them along to me. I'm going to read it so that I try to stay within time as well. First of all, I don't think that there's a single cause to the achievement gap. If there was, we would have solved it a long time ago. I think there are numerous factors involved. Mary certainly mentioned some of those, poverty, emotional health challenges and health challenges, homelessness, and also, very importantly, the effects of institutionalized racism. I've come to understand the concept best from one of my fellow alma mater from the University of Wisconsin, a professor named Gloria Ladson-Billings, and she refers to the achievement gap is simply a system of a larger underlying problem, that she talks about it as an education debt. And she compares the achievement gap to our national debt. Every year, we fall behind or we don't. But she gets at the deeper meaning of that, which is the cumulative impact of the deficits that we have every year, as opposed to the national debt, pardon me. And so she talks about the fact that we continue to work on small answers for the achievement gap when we need to really look at those larger underlying problems that contribute to this year by year by year deficit that we've accumulated. I think it's clear that our school system has been in a long transition from one that was originally designed to assimilate European cultures to one that has tried unsuccessfully to integrate all cultures. And I believe that the reasons for that lack of success have to do with, again, this focus on short-term fixes, an unwillingness to make foundational changes to our current system, and the failure to understand the critical importance of honest engagement with students, parents and caregivers, teachers, and our communities. I do think that the district's policy on racial equity and the overall strategic vision for closing the achievement gap represent a promising start, but I don't see the kind of detailed blueprint that I think we need to have to make sure that these important goals unlock the potential in all of our kids. So what do I think needs to be done? I think the first step is to acknowledge that the parent-teacher relationship is integral to any solutions we have. Teachers have to be supplied with the proper training and support, as well as practical and implementable tools for the classroom. I also think that we need to recognize that the parents are the first teachers of our kids, and so they have to be partners. We have to ensure that our curriculum includes accurate and balanced representations of all cultures, and we need to teach the whole child, and that means bringing back the arts, and that means physical education. I also think we need to take a look at our tests. We're trying to reach goals set by standardized tests. Do they really measure achievement for our kids? Do they measure the skills and abilities that they bring to school? Thank you very much.
Well, good words from both of the first two speakers. I too would like to read what I wrote, because I am a writer. African Americans, Hispanics, Native Americans, and Asians have never been fully included and integrated into this society. It's a national disgrace. Has to stop. Got to be included. In ways that are subtle and blatant, people of color have been cheated, mistreated, and viewed as inferior by many whites throughout American history. To live in such a country is inherently and deeply dehumanizing and stressful. That stress, combined with an inhumane and anti-democratic economic, political, and criminal justice system, and justice is in quotes, please understand that, makes reaching one's potential nearly impossible for many people of color. In nearly all measures of well-being and achievement, from health to home ownership to participation and representation in the media to political representation to saving for retirement, many people of color trail their white counterparts. It is true, I know, man. The achievement gap is part of this tragic reality. Because the achievement gap does not exist in isolation, it cannot be addressed in isolation. The broader failures of American society must be remedied. Specifically, we must create a society with economic, political, and authentic media democracy. We must always remember the essence of democracy, the mission of democracy, and the measure of democracy is the dispersal and equitable sharing of power. Whenever and wherever people do not have equitable access to power, democracy cannot exist. And so I think the ultimate solution to the achievement gap is an infusion of authentic democracy in our society. To create authentic democracy, we must have full employment based on a cooperative and public utilities model economic system. We must have a reduction of the work week so parents have more time to raise their kids and have a less stressful life. We must also have a single payer healthcare system that covers everyone. We're the only country in the world that puts the profits of the pharmaceutical companies and the health insurance companies before the well-being of our fellow citizens. It is ridiculous. And I would say if this healthcare system somehow worked okay, maybe I could accept it. But it is the worst healthcare system in the world measured by spending and the outcomes of our healthcare system. It is tragic. America trails about 35 other nations in the overall health of our people. So I'll have more to say about what the source of the problem is and how we can fix it in a few minutes here, but my time is just about up, and unlike somebody I want to run over.
Well, everybody before me has, in some respects, part of the problem being the fourth person is a lot of people before you have said what you would like to say. So I don't want to go on excessively, but I do want to emphasize some of the things that happened. We're dealing with a system in which we've built in a lot of issues related to how people of color are treated, respected, valued, dealt with in a humane way, and we have a system that in our schools reflects what we have in our community. So when we look at the achievement gap, we also look at this from a deficit mentality that is actually not healthy. We need to look at the assets that our children have and think creatively about how we work with the kids in our community and what the resources are that we have in our community to support children. Because we can talk about how we have constructed a system in our society that allows what we have in terms of wealth accumulation, housing segregation, lack of employment, lack of safety and security to persist. But our schools get this visited on them every day. And so our teachers are the ones who are dealing with this every day. And the most important thing that we can think about, and one of the reasons why this persists in our schools, is we have schools that are built on a model that doesn't work for a significant number of our children. And we need to think creatively about how we're going to change that. So when I think about the achievement gap and I think about who's coming to school every day, I think about the kids who ride the bus with my sons. Every day, my son takes the bus with a variety of kids from a variety of backgrounds. And he goes to school every day with kids from different backgrounds. And every day, those kids sit next to each other and they're there to learn. And our commitment should be there to help them learn and do the best that we can by them. But what we have is a system that actually allows for a lot of differentiation in terms of the resources that we have in our schools. So when we look at our schools, they're not equally resourced. When we look at the teachers that are there, they're not all doing the same thing. And we have to think about how we can work with the schools that we have so that they're more reflective of the needs of the children in the community that are there. There's not only instructional models, there are not only inequities in the ways that our buildings are resourced. There are the values that kids come with. Many of those kids who are coming to school are coming with such stress in their life. It's almost as if they're in a PTSD environment. And so how do we build in our schools, the ability of schools to handle the fact that we've got children with stress and deal with the stress that they have? That means we need to think of schools in a holistic way. And we haven't thought about them in a holistic way. And that's part of the reason why we get what we have in test scores. The final thing I would say is we have to think broader than just test scores as the measure of value of our children. And the fact that we focus on test scores is because of state and federal regulation. It gives us a sense of some basic information. But we need to think of all of our children and who they are as whole people. So some of what was said before about the lack of music and physical education and gym and all those other wraparound coursework is one of the reasons why we have kind of focused don't pick up on the values that we have of our children.
After many years of observing and interacting with youth, with students prior to joining the school board, and in the 7.5 years that I've been on the school board, I firmly believe that the name of the gap is not achievement gap. Our students can achieve. I've seen it and I know it. The name of the gap for me is education equity gap. That's what we've been missing in this country and in this school district. The opportunities for students, as my fellow candidates have named, students from communities of color, students from families with lower socioeconomic background, students who've immigrated from other countries and are learning academic English, students who are receiving various types of student special education services, where that gap exists as an education equity gap. So what I want to address are these external numbers that we see in the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessment MCA tests, the gaps in reading, the gaps in math, the gaps in science. These are gaps that show that the educational equity still is not being shared with all of our students. As we know in this room, this public education institution in the United States was not created to bring success to all of our babies who come into the school building. It's a Eurocentric system. It is not a system that was made to be successful for slaves as they became free people. It was not a system that was made to be successful for the American Indians who lived here before the Eurocentric people arrived. It was not a system that was made to be successful for the Latinos and our Asian families and students who have arrived here in the past few decades. So that's the work that we have to address and to be more intense about, and to double down if we need to knock down those barriers of success for all of our students, all of our young leaders, as I call them. So that is the gap for me. So my belief and my expectation is that every one of our 3,200 students, teachers, come to the classroom saying, what else can I do to lift up every student who comes before me? And I know they come to the table ready to do that. And my belief and my expectation is that every one of the 3,700 other employees in St. Paul Public Schools wake up every day saying, what can I do as I drive this bus, as I serve food in the cafeteria, as I clean the building, as I welcome the families being a clerk, as I lead the buildings, as I work in administration, what else can I do to lift up all the students in this district so they are soaring with academic achievement? So these numbers, these differences that we're seeing in the external measurement that Steve was just talking about, no longer exists, those educational equity gaps. So that to me is how I define what the achievement gap is. Let's keep working to reduce those educational equity gaps.
Okay, well, I'm sorry if I seem ingenuous about through my reading this, but I really need to do it to keep myself on time. So through the information that the St. Paul Public Schools have provided, I understand the achievement gap through data that's provided to the public. So I see the achievement gap through our standardized tests that were established through the No Child Left Behind in order to create a couple basic areas, reading and math, that are indicators of school success and could be looked at across the board throughout the United States. Well, these tests were not designed to be an end, rather a beginning. It's important that these tests are made public, but one of the problems is their broad general use for parents to decide what schools to send their children to. So schools, for example, like St. Anthony Park Elementary or Capitol Hill Middle School, become choices for parents who are prepared to read data with an educated assumption that their children will get a safe, smooth education. Of course, we're not going to be able to suppress our test results, and we don't even want to. So it becomes our job to develop a St. Paul school community that will work toward meeting the needs of all our children. How do we do this? With a strategic plan, with pilot programs and lab schools that we can follow. By acknowledging and analyzing parent choices, and by marketing our schools to inform parent choices beyond the standardized tests. We have a strategic plan to help assure all our children succeed. This plan to close the achievement gap right now has a focus on racial equity. In spite of the focus, and hopefully enhanced through this focus, the district administration has told us that they continue to look for increased achievement for all children. Well, I'd like to see some programs piloted, followed, and marketed as lab schools. For instance, I happen to be very interested in early childhood education, but I'm still trying to piece together the data and information available regarding the St. Paul's participation in and analysis of its programs. Until we have preschools that our St. Paul community will want to send their children to, we won't be able to access necessary money that, for instance, our governor was ready to hand over to us. We have to inform the stakeholders in St. Paul about what our idea of a world-class early childhood program looks like. We need to assure that there's proper space available, and we have to spread the word. Early childhood opportunities are indicators of school readiness and community acceptance. It's the ideal place to narrow the achievement gap. It's important that these schools are scrutinized with as much diligence as our colleges. This is the most important place for highly trained, experienced teachers with strong background in child development. We must be vigilant about licensing in this area, and this should not be an area where we accept pending licenses and unprepared substitutes. Our early childhood area is a perfect place to develop lab schools and efficiently close the achievement gap. Just one example.
Greg Copeland again. I told you that I think we need a new superintendent. I'm an old newspaper reporter, and I look for the facts. And the facts really haven't been mentioned tonight. I think we ought to take a look back at what the gap is, and is measured by various barometers. Superintendent Silva was noticeably absent when the MCAs were reported. If you notice the news coverage, it was all about other staff members delivering the news. The news is that in math, for 2015, the gap's at 37% in the black community of students in our schools. It was 35 in math in 2011. We're moving in the wrong direction. Asian students had a 9% gap, no change between the 2 years of 2011 and 2015. Hispanics actually improved 1 point. From 32% gap in 2011 to 31 this year. The American Indian students, no change, 33% gap. I think the other thing we ought to look at too is a measure that is on the Department of Education website. It's called On Track for Success. In 2010, about the first year that Ms. Silva had to answer for, 54.5% of our students in this district were on track for success in math. By 2014, that number had dropped by 12.9 points to 41.6. And unfortunately, in reading, we have much the same story. 53.3% of our students were on track in 2010. By 2014, they were falling off the track. 11.8% less for a 41.5% on track. That's among all our students. The other reason I think we've got a gap is we don't spend our money well. We don't spend our money on our students. Look at the budget. It's online. I'm not making up the number. It's there for you all to look at. We have a number of funds, the general fund being the master fund for education here. That doesn't include the buses and the food service and all the rest. But it does include a direct allocation for students to their schools. And here's the bad news. Only 48.22% in the 2016 budget will be spent on direct allocation to our schools. That has to change. We need to be spending much more then less than half of the $525 million in the general fund at our schools. And I'll come back with an answer as to where I think we can invest that money wisely. Thank you.
Thank you. I will read the second question, and then we'll go down and answer it again. The second question, what needs to be done to end the achievement gap in St. Paul Public Schools?
I thought I tried to answer that question on the first round. That's why I ran out of time. We have a lot of kids in our school who are living with stress, and life is hard. So I think that requires a different approach to education. And if our schools look more like Head Start, I think we would be more successful. That means that we have to start early with our families. We have to be working with parents as soon as their babies are born. We need to make sure that their basic needs are met and that their families are stable so that they can be supportive to their kids in their schools. And when they get to school, our schools need to embrace them as full partners. Parents need to feel comfortable in the schools. They need to know that their concerns will be heard, that they are valued for what they know about their children, and that they can be partners with their schools in working with their children. We need to make sure our instructional practices and our learning environments meet the learning styles and the needs of our children living with stress. Learning needs to be active, exciting, exploratory, and fun, and include a variety of ways to express themselves in arts and music, in other ways. They also need access, again, to health services in the schools, mental health services, and even oral health services, so that they've got the energy to learn. They need help in learning how to manage their own emotions, being able to recognize emotions in other people, and to see adults in their world as helpers, that they can go to them when they need something. Kids who come to school need to know that their teachers like them, they want what's best for them, and they believe that they have the ability to achieve. For many of them, the teachers are the ones who are their cheerleaders, the ones who really do believe in them, and our schools need to do that. So that means we've got to have teachers and staff and leaders that come from the communities that our children come from. They need to have people who look like them for their models and to know what's possible for them. And we need a way of integrating those teachers into our schools so that they are ready for the challenges that an urban school district has to offer them. That means in their higher education, their teacher training programs, they need some experience in working with our kids that come with more needs, with more challenging behaviors. We need to figure out ways to get those teachers that come from those communities into teacher training programs. So some loan forgiveness programs, scholarships, other ways to get them into our schools. Finally, we need to have a way to work with our older kids when they're showing us that they're in stress. And sometimes that behavior comes out as challenging, violent behavior. And what it means is they need to be paid attention to, and we need strategies for getting those needs that they're trying to tell us about met.
Are you ready to start over? You know, I think the largest barrier right now to the overcoming the achievement gap is the lack of community built around the solutions. And I think that there is not the necessary degree of trust that we need to have in order to move forward together. There have been a lot of great programs introduced over the past years. Unfortunately, two or three of the most important were ganged all at the same time. They weren't spaced out and sequenced so that we could make sure that we were doing it correctly. It's kind of like some of our kids who we don't find, we're not really making sure that they're competent in their skills. We're moving them ahead. We can't do that with these important programs. We don't necessarily get a second chance, as somebody pointed out to me. 1 year for your kid, that doesn't work is maybe not such a bad thing. 1 year for my kid might be the end. So we have to get serious about making sure that we have strategies for implementation that work. I think that, unfortunately, the trust issue comes into play when we have teachers and our staff at sites that feel under-supported. And when they've tried to communicate what they feel is or is not working, they are under the perception that compliance has become much more important than an honest back and forth conversation and a working together to figure out how to solve these problems. Many parents, students, and teachers feel disconnected, disrespected. These critical programs and approaches that might have led to real progress have seen uneven success. And I don't believe that there are measurements in place to really test the efficacy of the programs. You can look at the results, and again, I have some questions about our MCAs as to what they do test in terms of achievement, but those numbers are down. They've been mentioned. We also have a declining population in St. Paul of our kids. Kids across all cultures are moving to other districts or are going to charter schools or private schools if they have that kind of capacity. 48% of our kids that graduate from our public high schools need remedial classes in order to get into a 2 or 4 year college. So we have to have open and honest conversations at a classroom level and with community input. We have to reconnect and re-engage. We have to make sure that there's a strategy developed by our communities together with input so that we can have a strategy that works. And we have to try new approaches. We can't be afraid to change the system from top to bottom. Thank you very much.
One of the things as a nation, as a school district, we absolutely have to do is move away from this testing-based mania. I was fortunate enough to go to an alternative college in Michigan called William James College. It was at Grand Valley State University. I never took one test in my entire college career. What we did was project-based education. We would read, write, we'd offer position papers, we'd defend our positions. I think we need to move toward a project-based education system rather than this mania on testing. Also, as I mentioned before, we have to take a big look. I mean, we have to take a look at the big picture and the root causes of the problems. As I said, and I think we all know, people of color have never been fully included in this society. And so that's why I'm taking this opportunity here today. We have to really take a serious look at reparations for Black Americans. And one way I think that we can do that is, you know, just the African Americans, obviously, were picking cotton as slaves. We've got to turn that around. I think we can have an African American clothing company that can supply all our students all the shoes and clothes they need, made from industrial hemp that's grown right in our state, providing good jobs in our city and in our state, good high-paying jobs, and we could have a school right at those factories that make the clothing that we all need. I mean, look around. Everything we're wearing comes from halfway across the world. Makes no sense at all. We're burning fossil fuel to do this, and we're exploiting third world labor of people of color over there. We can make everything we need right here. And again, one of the ways to do that, I strongly believe in reparations for African Americans. It's tough to know exactly how to do it, but again, I would support the African American clothing cooperative, what I would call. Also, white, rich Americans have had well over a century to provide our energy in this country. I call for the African American Energy Cooperative. I am positive they can do better than the rich white guys that have been running things for over 100 years. And all this will trickle down to our students, because when you've got parents that are working hard and bringing in good money, I think it's going to really help that student feel like he's got a place in the society. Again, like I said, I worked for 17 years with students, and it was tough seeing the kids 5, 6, 7 years old coming to school filled with anger. And I don't think it was at me or other teachers. I think they looked around, and kids are smart. They know that society is cheating them. They know it. okay? And so we got to stop this cheating of our, especially the African-American kids and Hispanics too. I mean, all people of color have just gotten the short end of the stick. I'm a former competitive athlete, and one of the things that I always liked was fair play. We do not have fair play in this country. Until we do, until we get rid of these clowns that are running Washington, you know, we're going to keep struggling with the same problems over and over again. I'm sure the black people here don't have to say, oh, this is a new problem, you know, being mistreated. No, man, it's been going on for centuries. We've got to stop it. And we can do it with the school board, I think. We can, we're limited as a school board, but our ideas are not limited. We've got to have big ideas on the school board. Thanks.
I'm glad he said the school board, because I want to kind of put the focus back on kind of the job that we're being asked to do, which is, I think, something that we have to think about, the role of the board. And I think that starts with a board that is connected to the community, committed to closing the gap, and willing to set expectations for administrators, staff, and students. This means that the board sets a clear number of defined goals, clearly articulated goals and outcomes for the district, with the expectation that the board's going to hold staff accountable for progress. And our decisions on staffing, curriculum, resources have to be in alignment with these goals. If something isn't working, we look at why and we decide how and what needs to change. And if you look at the work that the district is doing and you try to find where on the website the board has committed to specific outcomes, it's really hard to find. That doesn't work in holding the board or the district accountable. So we need to get real about the commitment that the board is making to the community and the leadership that the board is providing to the district to do this. But the district needs to think a lot more creatively about how it's meeting the educational needs of students and involve educators, families, and students in the process of determining how the schools could be more effective. If we are supposed to have strong schools to support strong communities, are those schools organized and supported around the needs of our students and the communities that they serve? What can we learn from some of the successful schools that are outside of the St. Paul Public Schools, and what are those practices that we can use in the schools? What are families, students, and community members asking of their schools? How do we look at supportive services for students so that they reinforce teaching and connect students and families in a holistic manner? And I'm thinking in terms of a citywide Promise Neighborhood. In addition to college readiness, what connections can the district facilitate so that we connect students to employment opportunities such as buildings trades so that they can graduate career ready? The board also needs to be the rallying point for the community commitment to close these achievement disparities. The district's current equity work with educators and district staff and leadership is a starting point. But there's a lot more work that needs to be done. And in addition to the public schools employees, our schools need coordinated support from other sectors. A lot of the work has been started to do that, and it has to be more coordinated and more citywide. And I'm talking about corporate, nonprofit, faith-based, neighborhood community organizations that can support this work. Every parent, caregiver, and community member in the city deserves to believe that their schools are excellent. We're a long way from there in a lot of places in this city. And the board members have to recognize that we do not, whoever it is, have all the answers, but we have to be part of a process and facilitate a process that taps into the wisdom that exists in our community, not only in the minds of the folks in 360, not only in the minds of the board, so that we can actually move ourselves in the right direction.
Sadly, in the years I've had a chance to have conversations with school board colleagues from around the country in my service of our board on the Council of Urban Boards of Education, and conversations around the Twin Cities in Minnesota and conversations within St. Paul, we haven't found those magical solutions to eradicate and end the education equity gaps. But I do believe there are some practices that we have in school district right now and that we can intensify and strengthen over the coming years that will help eradicate that gap. Number one, I firmly believe every one of our 39,000 students need to be reading at grade level. It is a basic education right every one of our students have. It gives them the confidence. It gives them the ability to comprehend what they're learning. It gives them those critical thinking skills, and it gives them the coolness to be excited learners in our school. hey, I got this. I can understand this piece of literature my teacher gives me, this math assignment, math problem that my teacher gives me. I can understand the sciences I'm learning. I can understand history, all the content area. And I know our teachers are working hard to help every student be able to read at grade level and beyond to excel in that, along with the education assistants and teaching assistants and others who provide an intervention for students who need help. But to me, that's number one, because once that happens, I believe our students are going to soar to achievement, life achievement and academic achievement. So you see students like my friend's grandson, Simeon, who had a terrible life event. His father was killed, became a student who wasn't a good learner, who wasn't good behavior in his classroom, disruptive. And then found an adult, actually through Freedom School, one of our programs that helps students gain that love of learning, love of reading, connected, said, I now want to learn. I want to become a better student. And moved on and now is a successful student, successful learner because of that. I know that's how our teachers, how all of our employees, how the adults in the community can connect with our students. So that's going to help address, eradicate those gaps. Moving from there is helping students to be excited about learning. That's part of this personalized learning through technology that we have happening in the school district right now, because that's how our students learn. You know, my mom gets mad at my nephews and my nieces and my grandnieces because they're on their cell phone or on their computers, but that's how they learn, that's how they connect, and that gets them excited about communicating. Let's keep them excited like that about learning, bringing the learning to what helps the students, what gets them truly excited. I believe what's going to help address the gaps is to have our students see adults who care about them, but especially see adults from their community. So having more of our teachers of communities of color in immigrant communities. We've increased the number of building leaders from the start of Superintendent Silva's term from 17% for communities of color to now 51%. So that's helping our students, just having those connections. There are many other ways to address the gap. I look forward to having those conversations.
Hello? Oh, there it is. Okay, hello. As a St. Paul stakeholder, it's been very difficult to access information about our schools from our schools. It would serve our district's goals if it did a better job of informing and marketing to our public. So I am aware, but with a lot of searching of some really good programs that we are working on, schools that are very happily working on what they're doing, and reading is improving and math is improving and the children are excited to come, but we don't hear about that. So I think we need to do a better job about informing and marketing. The achievement gap is not just about the students. Now, this is very sensitive, but it's also about the parents and the teacher's ability to bring the parents to the table who have not had positive experiences with schools themselves. So this can be achieved through awareness, which I believe we're already working on. But we need to be vigilant with the work that's being done, make sure that it continues. Our perception of an achievement gap can be a barrier. So one teacher recently suggested that we refer to it as an opportunity gap, that calling it an achievement gap just positions the children to feel like they're not achieving and that it's their problem when it's our problem. Now we need, there's just a variety of things, and I've heard many of them that I strongly agree with. But we also need community-based student-supported classrooms, and I think we're moving in that direction a bit in our district, hearing from our students. Our children lose out on authentic community opportunity when special ed and gifted and talented children are removed from their general education classrooms to access their services. That's not doesn't have to be necessary. There are children, of course, who need opportunities to distance themselves, but our gifted and talented children must have access, along with their general ed classmates, to a highly trained teacher prepared to teach a rigorous program with the tools that he or she needs without having to go elsewhere for it. Our general education program should just be strong. Teachers have difficulty providing individualized learning. Our iPads look like they'll be a support to this, but our students also need adults who can give them attention as they need it. If financially possible, additional classroom support has to be added. So I'll stop there.
Well, there is no magic at 360 Colburn. But let's move on from that. Let's move on from that. In addition to being a former reporter, my second job after being a reporter was involving myself in community action. It's gotten kind of a tough rep lately here in the adjoining Twin City neighborhood of Minneapolis. But, you know, those programs, and we talk about the war on poverty, and some of us decry the war, but I would say the war really wasn't ever fought. But what I learned working for Community Action, and I was a deputy director of the agency I worked for in Florida, in a rural community, was that our program was dependent on what the people in the community wanted us to do with the money that we were writing the grants for job training, for transportation and medical appointments, whatever it might be, for whatever age group we were serving, whatever the problem was, the people defined it. I want to ask you to reflect, who was it that told us we needed, who was it in the community that told us we needed to have a $1 million plus Pacific education group arrive from San Francisco to straighten out our community and instead create the kind of discord that we've had over the last 5 years in our schools? The behavior problems that have been complained of by teachers, the discipline problem that have been complained about by parents and teachers, because we have to embrace some new thinking about people's behavior in the classroom that we haven't had before. Who in the community asked for this? I would submit we have one man. Any other hands? We have one man. We have two men. Three, four. Okay. Well, you know what? There were a lot of people that never got to participate in that decision. Superintendent Silva has been running a top-down administration, an administration where she decides and the board rubber stamps what the project is. That's the reality. And the reality is that has not worked, as I previously presented the numbers both from the state DOE and from our own test scores. It has failed, and it has failed each year by just a little bit more. We've dug ourselves in a hole. We have to get out. And one thing voters need to do, because this is your community, this is your school system, folks, we need a change at the top. Because really, the only decision that this board gets to make in terms of hiring is who's going to serve as the superintendent. And the lack of transparency, the arrogance of the board to hire her for three more years is beyond belief. It's a political sweetheart contract that, frankly, we need to eradicate.
Okay, thank you, candidates. Our last question, question number three, is what will you do to overcome the barriers that you see within the achievement gap? And you will have 4 minutes to answer that question.
First, we have to define the barriers. We'll put that in the front. So we've all talked about the systemic racism in our community, and I think that's a huge issue that we can't overlook. And our schools need to be involved in the community in working with our leadership in the city and county and figuring out ways to sort of
redesign our system so they work for all people. We also need to make sure our kids are safe, and that's one of the things that our school district needs to work with the county as well, to make sure that if they identify children or families that look like they're at risk of child abuse or violence, that they are working together to get interventions in those homes. Funding is always an issue. That seems to be the biggest barrier for
everything, but we'll start with early childhood education. It is, while it's gaining in some support, it is still woefully inadequate. We really need to have family home visiting programs. Our ECFE programs need to be working with really young families and working with the family home visiting programs in the health department to make sure that all families are getting that need that kind of support are getting it, so that kids get a good start. Our child care programs are also unfunded, and there are lots of kids who don't have access to child care, and they're at home with aunties, neighbors, and people who don't necessarily know how to care for them. We've got to figure out how to make child care more accessible. The before and after school programs are also needed, and that coordination between the community programs and the schools need to happen so that kids can get support wherever they are. It seems like another barrier is the lack of teachers that come from our communities of color. And I think that can be resolved in a couple of ways. One, we need a culture in our schools that supports teachers. Right now we have some distrust going on between teachers and administration, and what we really need is administration teachers working together to be focused on the vision and to be pulling together so that all kids are getting teachers who are happy to be there and engaged. We also need to look at those teacher training programs, as I talked about before. Our teachers need better training so they know how to handle kids who have extra challenges at home. Resources are also needed for those teachers to be able to develop relationships with their kids. That means we've got to look at maybe smaller class sizes in some of our schools, even smaller than we negotiated in the contract. Maybe we need more teachers, maybe we need two teachers in each classroom. We definitely need more home visiting so that teachers can get to know their families. And then we need resources for support services. But I think one of the biggest barriers in our schools and in our communities is that we don't necessarily think very big. When we talk about education reform, we often talk about just doing more of the same. And I think it's time for us to start thinking differently about what kids need and what we can do for them, and to start being a little bit more imaginative, well, a lot more imaginative, and not let limited resources and some stinking thinking by some of our leadership hold us back. We need to do what is right for our kids and make sure that we aren't losing any of them.
I apparently answered this last time. I guess I was out of sync with the questions, but let me reiterate that I do think trust is important. I think that, as I said earlier, we have to be able to support the key relationship between the teacher and the student in the classroom. That's where all learning happens. And when we, there's an urgent need. No one needs to wait or wants to wait, but we can't let that urgency overpower a strategy that will actually see sustainable success. Because when we hurry, when we want to protect, when we want to try to be patronizing sometimes, what happens and the people who suffer are those kids. They're the students. They're the ones who are put in situations where they're not comfortable, where they're not learning, where they're not understood, and where they feel out of place. And we have to make our schools places that welcome our kids and our community. I think that that's perhaps the biggest barrier. When you look at a big program, it's a top-down approach. It's easy, I think, to imagine that there's going to be a large organization that saves us all with the answer. But what it comes down to is us. What it comes down to is the communities working together to make sure that our kids get the education they need. And I agree, I think we have to be bolder. I think we need to look at different ways and different systems of education. But it has to start with the children and the teachers in the classroom. That's where we have to put our focus, and that's where we have to put our support. And right now, our system fights that. If there's innovation in our district, it tends to go somewhere else. It tends to go to charter schools, or it's not organized and measured so that we can build on it and find out how those things are working and implement them in other places. But we have to open things up to be able to let people who have creative ideas and people who have those relationships and people who know those kids, we have to make them a part of the conversation. And that's what I mean by saying to turn the system upside down. It has to start there rather than up here saying, here's all the money we have, here's the big program, you figure it out down there. We have to get in the schools and let the kids and the teachers and those parents and our professionals work together to make that happen. So trust is the key to that. Community building is the key to bringing trust back into that. We have to be able to sit down together to get it done. Thank you.
I fully realize that the school board members have very limited power, but again, that doesn't mean we have to have limited thinking. Let me draw on something from my experience of 17 years working as a substitute teacher, and this happened over and over again, and I think it's indicative and reflective of the approach our leaders, the leadership class in this country, has to public problems. Those of us that live in Minnesota know that in the middle of winter, you've got to put on warm pants and shirts and sweaters. And let me tell you, so many times I walked into a classroom, coming from outdoors, 10 degrees, I walk into the classroom, it's 82 degrees. And I'm thinking, how can we have a society that can't even properly heat and cool our schools? And let me tell you the answer that the principals always gave me when I walked into a room, you know, wearing a wool sweater and a turtleneck, when I should have been probably wearing shorts and a t-shirt. Well, I don't need this. Wearing shorts and a t-shirt. And the teachers, or the principal's answer was always this: open a window, turn on the fan. That's what we do in public policy in the United States. There's problems that we should be able to foresee. There's problems that we should be able to foresee and take care of before they happen, such as repairing boilers that are 50 years old and of course break down or overheat or something. But for whatever reason, and I think it's moral and intellectual incompetence and indifference on the in the leadership class at the highest levels that permits us or prohibits us from solving our problems in advance. I'm sort of glad today it rained so much because it made me start to think, and this is typical about what goes on with all public policy, particularly in schools. We spend our time, the roof is leaking, and we spend our time arguing about, you know, what buckets should we use? Should we give the school kids raincoats or should we give them umbrellas? And no one thinks to think, fix the roof, man. I mean, roofs need to be fixed every 20 years or something. We can't figure out things in advance. Our leadership class in this country has zero foresight and really probably zero interest, because whether it's Silver making her $220,000 a year or CEOs making their $15, $20, $80 million a year, they don't care about you. They don't care about me. The ruling elite in this country has always waged a very cruel war on poor, working class, and middle class people, and of course people on the bottom rungs of the socioeconomic ladder, which usually tend to be people of color. They bear the price of, they bear the brunt of this callousness of our leadership class. And again, I realize that as a school board member, you can't really do anything about the United States Congress, but we can at least least raise the issues. It's inexcusable, the conditions of our public schools, the physical plant of the public schools. It's inexcusable, these crowded classrooms. We have to dramatically reduce the size of the class size, and we can do that by hiring more teachers, providing more jobs. And let me remind everybody, this is not a poor country. We are an incredibly wealthy country. The deficit comes in not with how much money we have. The problem comes a total lack of democracy in this country and determining how our great wealth is used, circulated, taxed, and taxed. I mean, it is ridiculous. We've got to start, again, looking at root causes. That's the only way we're ultimately going to solve all of our problems, including the achievement gap, is let's begin to think of the root causes. And one quick mention again, we've got to all band together to end this war on drugs. It is devastating our urban communities and people of color. And I think that will be a big help, too, in helping to end the achievement gap.
I think when we're looking at barriers to getting the work done to reduce the achievement gap, I think we have to get real about what it's going to entail to actually get the job done. And I think it takes a combination of focus from the boards and the board being willing to make some hard decisions, but also understanding that there's a moral imperative to do this work, because we need to address the fact that we have the disparities that we have, and we can't wait because we can't keep losing more and more generations of kids. But we also have to move beyond some zero-sum thinking, which is, I think, part of what inhibits our ability to actually get effective. People take the perspective that what we have to do is, if you have yours, I can't have that. You can't have that because that means somebody else doesn't have it. So we need to be thinking in terms of how we increase our capacity to do the work. And that means that we look at the resources that the district has, they're not endless, and make some choices about how we're going to align using money and staff and facilities with the goal of reducing the achievement gap. And then at the same time, look at how we can increase the capacity of our system to do this work. And what I'm talking about is leveraging all of the resources of our city. And that means community groups, philanthropic groups, corporate resources, the human capital of volunteers and mentors in the community, because the right person to work with a child may not be the classroom teacher. It may be someone in the community who can relate to the child in a much more real and organic way, and we need to be able to bring the full value of those relationships into the classroom to move the needle in a coordinated way. And the other thing is to think about the level of cooperation we do have with other local government agencies, higher ed institutions. We are rich in St. Paul with a lot of resources. But if we want to make this happen, we need a board that is willing to say, this is a priority for our community. We, as the representatives of the city of St. Paul, know that this is important to our community, and we want to be in front of everyone trying to make this a community commitment. The other part of this, and this is something that John had just talked about before, is when was the last time the district came to the community and said, what do you want from our schools? What is the thing that you want to see happen in your child's school, and how can we make this happen? There's a level at which we have to move beyond this expert model of how we make decisions around education to incorporate more people of our community in the process. The level of disconnection that I hear from people when I talk to them as we go door to door, and for people who say when they don't have children in the district, well, I don't have a child in the district, so I don't know if I have authority to say something about the schools. Every person in this city, whether they pay property taxes through their home, or whether they are a renter, or whether they are just walking in the streets, has a stake. And one of the biggest barriers that we have to making moves on the achievement gap is the sense that we don't collectively share this responsibility to every child in the city. So if we're going to make the move to actually attack the achievement gap, we need a board that is willing to come to the community and say, work with us, help us, tell us what we need to do to work with you. Give the teacher some authority to be able to give the input that she or he has so that they can talk about what they need to be successful. And I think we have to move beyond the sense of hopelessness that often happens when we talk about the achievement gap, because it's been so attractable for so long, the sense that we can't do anything about it, so we just have to kind of live with it. We can't accept that status quo collectively. We can't not hold our schools accountable, our teachers accountable, our parents and our families accountable, and ourselves accountable for the fact that this is happening in our community. But we need to be real, we need to be authentic about our desire to change it, and we need to be concrete about the things that we're going to do to make it happen.
One of my biggest disappointments as a current board member has been the fact that not all of our students are achieving at the level I know they're capable. I see some of our students who have high achievement are thriving in our school system. We have many who are doing that, but it's not happening for all of our students. And for me, indeed, the barriers to that education equity, that true equity for all of our students, are ones I've been working on and that I will continue working on over the next 4 years. Most of those barriers are environmental factors that affect St. Paul Public Schools specifically and public education in general. Number one is, as great as the seven of us adults are here in front of you as candidates, and Zuki and Rashad who aren't able to join us tonight, and as great as all the adults in this room are and all of the adults in our school district, we need to step outside of our box thinking that we are going to be the ones who primarily determine how best to educate our students and what works best for them. And we need to listen more to some of our students. So this Tuesday, John and Ann and the rest of the board will be introducing a proposal that we'll be voting on to increase student voice in the school district, communicating with administration, communicating with us as board members. That's something that's been vitally important to me, and I think would help us adults make even better decisions to help move our students forward. Another environmental factor, barrier, is the belief and expectation of our students. I know each of the employees comes to school saying, every student can achieve and can be highly successful, but want to make sure that we don't see certain students because they look a certain way, whether it's skin pigmentation, body size, physical ability, because they speak a certain way, because of any factor, that they can only make it this high. And we see every student being able to make it this high. So we set that expectation and that atmosphere of high rigor, high achievement. You're going to be successful, you can make this happen. Another barrier that I've had a chance to address are unfunded mandates. So we talk about economics and budgets, and I have a chance every February to go and speak with the Minnesota delegation of senators and representatives in their work home in Washington. And I've talked with Representative Klein, and he gets it. And I've talked as leading the House Education Committee. And I talk with Senator Franken, and he gets it, along with the rest of our delegation. But we have an unfunded mandate 40 years ago, the Individuals with Disability Education Act that funds special education. Federal government is supposed to fund school districts' special education services at 40% of the school district's budget. Currently, it's 16%. Totally not acceptable. And Representative Klein told my Minnesota School Board Association colleagues and me this past February, you guys push hard on that. You push us in Congress, you push President Obama from his level, that we need to fund that act more. Because that hits our general fund, as Greg was talking about. Other barriers is patience with change. I'm proud that Superintendent Silva is a change agent. And then we make deep changes to break down traditional barriers to success in an institution like public education. It takes some time. Think about what's happened in the civil rights movement throughout this nation's history. So we need all of us, stakeholders, to be patient. I want to see those results change faster. I want to see those results change so Greg and others don't have to give reports about the gaps. And it's going to happen, but it's going to take longer than I would like. But we're going to be more intense about that as school board members, whoever the board members are seated in January, focus on that. So those are some of the barriers, environmental factors that we need to address, and I've been addressing and will continue to address if you choose to reelect me.
Let's see.
One of my concerns is as far as the testing goes, the standardized testing, is that all of our students get a fair opportunity to be tested. I hear from principals from schools that have to start their testing 2 months earlier in the year than the end of the year. Those children miss out on 2 months of, or some of them, 2 months of being educated. So I'm concerned that the standardized tests are really showing real evidence across the board. I'm concerned about our teachers. Our teachers do have so much power, and we need to be sure that we're supporting our teachers, that that we're working with the Department of Minnesota licensing to be able to access appropriately licensed teachers. We need to be working with the colleges that may not really be providing us with teachers with a bachelor's degree who are really prepared to meet the needs of all of our children. I would say for myself, there was a lot that I wasn't prepared with until I got further training. We want to be sure that we're measuring what our community desires for our children. So yes, it's good to have the measurement, you know, with the rest of the United States, and you know, about reading and math, and we hope that that makes some kind of sense to base things on for our students' achievement. But there's so much more than simply reading and math, and it needs to be, you know, teaching to the whole child. Can the children read data? Can they read music? And we also, I'm not seeing it, it's probably happening, but our communication, I feel, is so limited and so bad. But I would think we would want to be assessing our student achievement after high school. I keep seeing with early education, we want our children to be reading like they're fourth graders. And with our high school children, we want them to be working like college students or already making their millions. So, and it concerns me that we perceive our children in that way and not in their true developmental stages, where they can be high achievers, but I see children tried as adults for crimes. That's almost the same thing to me. So we need to see our children as children and support our children as children and support our teachers to provide rigorous expectations from our children.
Greg Copeland again. You know, I think really the change agents are certainly the voters that are going to be giving an accountability rating to each of us and to perhaps the superintendent and the board as they currently are constituted. But there's a greater accountability. And that is the change agents who you teachers, who you folks that are working in other capacities in our school system have in your hands. And what occurs to me in terms of a modest proposal that I'd like to offer is that the St. Paul Public School System actually adhere to the guidance of the American School Counselor Association. Some of you may be familiar with that. It's on the website of the St. Paul Public Schools. And allegedly, the school system, Mr. Hardy and others, supports what they propose. And here's what they propose: that there be a counselor for every 250 children. I hate to tell you what the number is in St. Paul, but I'm going to. Based on the 37,000, it gets a little worse if we go to 38, whatever number you want to pick, but 435 children per counselor. We've got, if you look at the site at least, when I looked at it, there were 85. That's not enough. We need to treat our students with some respect. We need to bring some professional guidance to their career early on, not waiting until the third grade when they've had a problem reading. You know, I live over on the east side. I'm about four houses off of Payne Avenue on Cook. It's down below Maryland. They say I live in a tough neighborhood. Well, you know, I've been there for 23 years. And I've seen a lot of children come and go. A lot of children age and graduate as well. But you know, I think I see a lot of busy parents, parents that are working two jobs where there are two parents in the household. And I think those parents could do with some help. And that's why I'm running, because I live on the east side and there's a lot of poor people on the east side. We've got one school board member that's over there. I've got a map here that I'll save for another night. But if you look at the past school board members, the current candidates for the board, and the current board, gosh, if you don't live in Como or Highland, you're pretty much out of the school board game. Well, I'm here to tell you that people on the east side are getting a little tired of riding in the back of the bus. We are going to vote on November 3rd, and I believe that democracy still is a good system. I went to the Magna Carta U.S. Constitution Day celebration before I came here tonight over at the History Center with Governor Dayton and Justice Gilday from the Supreme Court. And, you know, if we want to hold on to that document, the United States Constitution, we better start training some of our students to embrace some individual power in their lives, to give them the character that it's going to take to run their life. But you know what? They're going to need some support from people that know how to, you know, make a shortcut to that. Because on a when you don't have a lot of money, you know, you need a little extra help. And there is help out there, but we need some people to steer folks in the right direction. We need to give our students the goals that we give ourselves when we do what? Go to the doctor and get a medical plan to lose weight. I have to go. But we also do that with retirement planning. We do all kinds of planning in America. But the one thing we could spend some money on, and there's plenty of money, believe me, out of that $700 million budget, I can find the money, and we are going to hire 63 new guidance counselors, because we ought to be at least at the minimum recommendation of 250 students per guidance counselor. What else is better to spend money on? I'd rather spend $1 million plus that those folks at the Pacific Education Group took back to San Francisco on hiring some people that can get our students, our future citizens, who will be voting, who will be working hard for a long time, into the college of their choice, into the vocational college of their choice, into a job training program. Why aren't we offering some of those job training programs? Why don't we do some of that work at the school system? There's a lot of things.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're all done. It's been fun.
Yes, I want to thank all the candidates, and I want to say that your answers were very interesting, thoughtful, and informative. So thank you all, and thank you all for coming.
Again, I want to thank the Hallie Q. Brown Center. I want to thank SPNN for being here. I want to thank the League of Women Voters. Again, thank you to all the candidates, and thank you to our moderator, Catherine Page.